the last one. Any comments on the zoning?
No.
We know we'll just send it up. Then on the minutes of the February 3rd meeting.
I think those are the best minutes that were ever written.
What's that?
I heard him.
I did. I assume what he said was the best minutes that were ever.
I thought they were the best minutes ever written in the history of the planning board.
I'm going to agree. I think maybe you should do it all the time.
No, I will pass on that.
So can we have a vote on the minutes of February 3rd?
Motion to approve.
Approve.
Second.
Seconded. All those in favor say aye.
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 So move. Then on the one of February 11th, and I will not, obviously not voting on it. You can take the vote too if you might want to.
I'll make the motion to approve it.
Seconded, I guess.
Bob seconded.
Record, I did not vote on it. All those in favor?
Aye.
And as opposed, voted. And the January 6th meeting.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Nothing much.
Okay.
So Bob moved to approve. Bob moved to approve. I second it with the amendments.
What's up? Something to those. All those in favor? All right. The public hearing special permit continued, 222 Center Avenue, request withdrawn. Received.
So that's kind of sketchy, but I emailed him to affirm that was indeed what he wanted the board to do.
Just want to confirm that you are asking the board if you can withdraw your special permit application. If not, they can vote to deny it, but that means you cannot refile for 2 years. And that's on the building at 227 Center Avenue, if you recall, that kind of making it to more apartments. What's your pleasure?
Motion to let him withdraw.
Do what?
Motion to let him withdraw.
Second.
Motion made and seconded. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. And 605, public hearing, special permit application, floodplain wetlands protection district. Outdoor storage of materials, transport vehicles, and public storage site. Plan review, 940 Hancock Street, requested a continue the hearing. And that has been received. And Sean Riley sent us a letter to review it on April 13th meeting day.
Is that the same day we're also doing Summer Street?
That's Summer Street? No, Summer Street was its own meeting.
No, April 13th is the, because you couldn't make the first Monday in April,
right?
Right, so we're doing Summer Street on the first Monday in April, and then this is our regular meeting is the 13th.
Are we doing Summer Street in?
Motion to continue.
Motion made. Seconded.
Second.
Any further discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Yeah, I thought we were doing.
We're also sent a letter to all the neighbors.
I thought that we had continued this until.
And then 181 Brockton Avenue, as-built remediation continued. As you can see, I jumped all around this thing.
February 11th, I will fix that.
I
Riley, 500 Washington Street, with one point, principal, 1.8. This is a follow-up to a long project, and we're really trying to close it out with the as-built plan for the construction of what most people refer to as the batting cages building, which is the building that's set back off of Brockton Avenue, behind where Emmy's Deli used to be. The batting cages building, which was a commercial building back in the day, has been converted into eight apartment units. The project was originally approved in 2001, about 19 years ago, and I submitted the letter to you to review the history of it. We've gone through a number of building inspectors, a couple of additions to the building code, this building was one of the victims of those collapsed roofs, collapsed buildings during the 2015 blizzards, where the building, originally the intention was to renovate the existing structure, and then it ended up, after meeting with the building inspector and actually going into Boston to have a hearing with the building code licensing authority, we were directed to take down the whole building and kind of start from the basement, coming out the basement, the footprint, and move up. And that's what is there now, is the completed building, the eight units, and it's fully occupied. So Kyle Gavi has submitted the as-built plan, and I submitted a letter to kind of go down the checklist that I think it was PMP had written. And just to clarify, there was confusion about whether this was a 16-unit building or an eight-unit building. It's my understanding, my recollection isn't great from 19 years ago, but Glenn's here with me, that originally they were going to renovate the existing building and add on a wing to make it 16 units, basically double the size of the building. And through the process, it ended up that it was decided to just go with the renovation of the existing building, just only eight units, and that was essentially what was approved.
The foundation was, we had already had the foundation in for the addition on the building. It was probably, it was 20 feet long, and we were adding on to that. But the original building was the 60 by 60 with the foundation in for the other part. We had taken that foundation out.
So when the project changed after 2015 from a renovation to a reconstruction, then it actually created an opportunity for the points to do some more upgrades, meaning improving the drainage from what was the existing drainage with no gutters to better drainage. Everything was kind of upgraded. Separate and apart from that, after the building was done, they decided to also redo the entire parking lot out front, which is that shared common parking lot that's been in existence since Mr. LaPointe bought the property. It wasn't just repaved, it was literally reconstructed. I'm sure you remember that parking lot, it was a pretty old parking lot, there was a lot of pockets, problems, issues. So they decided to put some money into it after that building was done. They also put money into some of the other abutting commercial buildings, and then ripped up the entire parking lot and redid the base material and redid the pavement. In doing that, they unearthed an old part of the drainage system and an old a manhole for the phone company out towards Brockton Avenue, so those were cleaned up and rebuilt also. I've noted where, through PMP and through Kyle Gavi, I tried to put together a letter going down the checklist where questions were raised about, you know, where trees were. We moved some trees closer to the building. They questioned the number of parking spots, we confirmed those. We grossly exceed the number of required parking spaces for all of the uses that are in there. I think PMP's letter was looking at just the main parking lot, but wasn't aware that there are other parking lots in that area that those building users do own. I know one comment was, question was how the grass island in the middle that was in the middle of the main parking lot has been removed. It actually didn't exist at the beginning when Glenn bought it. Glenn actually put that in, and over the years, it became more of a problem because the trees weren't living. It was about a 4-foot wide grass strip. The trees kept dying, but more importantly, during the winter, it was a problem, not only for the difficulty of plowing, but really because it became natural that you would pile the snow on the island. So now you've created a wall down the middle where the customers of the different businesses would either have to walk around the entire wall or try to go over it, and that became an issue. So when it was repaved, it was the topography was put in, so all the drainage was improved. Drainage continues to flow out into the catch basins near Rockland Street. It continues to flow exactly where it goes now. No increase in the amount of rain or flow. It's just now, it's better. Everything's been upgraded. Everything's been restriped. I gave you the breakdown of the parking counts, and I think the letter tries to touch on everything, but if there's anything specifically, you'd like to talk about that, great. But we're looking for the approval of the as-built for the building itself, and if you'd like to talk about the parking lot separately, because it is a separate project. Glenn's here, he knows some of the history that I don't.
Just to refresh my memory on a couple things, who owns Abington Holdings?
It's a LaPointe family entity.
Okay. Who owns, I guess, Lot 2?
It's under the name, not even gonna catch me. It's all of that property. 1, 2, and 3 are all owned in some way by the LaPointe family. When they did their estate planning a number of years ago, Abington Holdings was created by their accountant. So it's all the same. And I did submit, one of the questions was there a common parking access easement, which I did submit this to Liz. It's already on record at the Registry of Deeds from 2017.
All right. So if I remember right, you came back in here 3 years ago to kind of give an updated plan for this? Was it 3 years ago, 4 years ago? You were in here at some point with a revised plan.
I think they filed an as-built plan, if this is what we're talking about. Kyle had filed an as-built plan. PMP had noted some discrepancies on his as-built plan.
November 27th of 18.
That might be right.
Is that the as-built?
This one.
Yeah, that's what happened. Kyle filed an as-built plan. PMP looked at it, had a bunch of notes about things that he compared that as-built to the 2001 plan. We sent Kyle back out to reconfirm some of those things. Some of those things were, you're right, you didn't count the parking spaces correctly. Some of those things were, like one issue was, the parking lot that services the 8-unit residential building to the rear has been shifted closer to the building. Mm-hmm. And that, the reason was because originally that parking lot and the building were, there was going to be a new building between them, or an extended building between them. When that got eliminated, it was about, it left a 100-foot walkway. So during construction, yes, the parking lot was shifted closer to the building. Same number of parking spaces, but it's closer to the building.
So when you say in this letter, the approved site plan, it's the 2001 approved site plan.
Right.
And when they came back in here within the past 6 years, because I remember sitting here seeing this, but I don't think I voted because I wasn't on the original one, or I wasn't aware of something, or I may have, but they came back in here for something. Was it? But it was the as-built that they were submitting?
Yes.
Yeah. Well, the as-built would have been in 18, yeah, November of 18.
All right, and so why are we here 2 years later looking at this again?
Oh, you know what? I know. What the heck was it? I'm trying to think of what it was. There was.
I want to say there was a driveway in front of the building or something.
Yeah, I'm trying to think of what it was. You came in and asked for something, and that's what... I don't remember what it was. I shouldn't remember, but I...
The only thing I can remember, it wouldn't be you guys, though. There was an issue, like, just, if you remember, during the late 2000s, the Permit Extension Act came into place, and that's how, this is one of those projects that was extended automatically 4 years and all. But I don't think I would have came back here to this board for that, because site plan review didn't expire. I don't recall.
It was something that it wasn't substantial. There was something. I've forgotten what it was.
Yeah. So my next question is why this was filed. The as-built was filed in 2018. Are we talking about this in 2020?
We got a letter from PMP in June of 2019, in response to the November 2018.
Oh, well, something to do with occupancy. Was it something to do with occupancy?
Yeah, for that building.
Yeah, and that's why, that's what you're thinking about.
Change of occupancy from the.
No, it was, they wanted to get occupancy of the building, and we hadn't signed off on the plan at all yet, and that's what you came for, and that's what they're thinking about.
Yeah, because we didn't have an as-built or anything, so.
Good memory.
Yep.
Okay.
Takes a while to bring it up.
That, okay, yeah, that was that. So the as-built, I don't even know if 2001, I don't think you're even holding bond for this.
No.
Right, 2001, you didn't require that. So we've been on our engineer to try to update the as-built plan and all, and then I offered to kind of put it in writing so he could have something to refer to. So that's where we are now. That what the plan in front of you should be an accurate as-built.
Okay. My concern is that there were a number of changes made to the plan as approved in 2001. That didn't hear anything about until you came back in here. I'm not saying those changes are wrong. They're probably better, make it a better project. But we have to know about these, I think, before we get to the stage. I mean, we have problems with other people around this town just changing wherever they feel like to as-built plans or site plans.
Right.
And I mean, we can't come down hard on them and then, you know, get something like this and say, oh, no big deal.
No,
I'm not looking to do anything. We're just saying, like.
We agree. I mean, and you know that Glenn has been here for a gazillion years, and we'll keep working until he can't work.
Well, the problem is the damn thing is 19 years old, and, you know, and honestly, I mean, I didn't pull a plan out every time we were doing something, you know, to look at it. I mean, I couldn't even find it.
I mean, it looks nice. I have no problem with these changes. I mean, they make sense.
I feel bad that this is how it ended up, you know, and we didn't do I didn't do anything underhandedly that didn't, you know, hurt the town or anything. But it just, you know, 20 years later, I'm looking at the thing and saying, you know, it's got to be done right.
No, you're right. We have to close the file. But you're right. If this was, especially under the current regulations, I think it's obvious that if, for example, a commercial developer wanted to move a parking lot 40 feet, they would come back to you or get somebody to approve it. You know, that type of thing. But I think you understand why it was done. So because it was make no sense to make people walk 100 feet to their car.
So why was it originally proposed that way?
Because that's where the building was going to be extended.
They're going to have to walk like 75 feet to get able to walk along.
Extension out this way, which part of them pushed out.
Oh. But this building I'm looking at is not a 60 by 60. You made it bigger.
No, the original was, I think, 60 by 60.
Well, there's a rectangle on the page.
Yeah, and then we had another foundations coming off of that already, like 20 feet off of that, and we've eliminated that.
Oh, and I
see. We were going to keep coming with the building with the 16.
You're going to go further that way. Oh, okay.
I didn't give it a thought that, you know, moving the button, well, naturally I moved the parking lot to make it easier for the tenants to come in and out of there.
Making everything small.
Yeah.
So.
Actually, when I was up there, the biggest concern I had was that there's a lot of kids in that building and that there's no real place to play.
Yeah, they play out on the right-hand side of the building.
Over there.
It's all grass.
In the grass.
Yeah. They've got a good soccer field going over there.
What I had wanted, to kind of disadvantage without the, maybe it's not disadvantage, maybe not having the consultant, but Carl... provide to back up whatever drainage that he finds that he can provide the calculations to be looked at. And I also wanted to, was concerned about the asphalt driveway doesn't have a curb around it, like any kind of curb to kind of stop the drainage from driving from skipping over that way, or from somebody just driving up over it and just driving out into the empty lot, so that
the grass comes down like this. Is that what you're talking about?
Well, the grass comes down, then there's a parking lot, and heading towards, I'm talking about right here.
Oh.
There's nothing there containing the water.
Right.
And that right now you can just drive right across
so
that area.
There's a grass strip there. There is a grass strip that parking lot, to separate it from.
The water that hits that rear parking lot flows down into the main, by the way.
That's where it all was.
Yeah,
I mean, put a berm on there, looking for an asphalt berm on that side. There's a concrete berm on the other side.
Concrete, yeah.
So you're concerned that water might flow this way?
Well, looking at that, there's nothing really to stop this. There's nothing to stop from the two surfaces to mitigate. You need something to back up the asphalt.
Yeah.
But also, I am, yeah, the drainage, keeping the drainage and this whole thing separate from it, so we're not pulling across it in the wintertime, and, because it's invisible there. I'm thinking of lights, right? Thinking of lights on that, yeah. But that was the only thing I saw, and kind of taking it into perspective, being over 19-year period, I can kind of see that. I think he's bringing it up, right, that there's a lot, we got so many examples that come in, and everyone asks for forgiveness, and, but over 19-year period is a little difficult. But I want to make sure that the consultants are happy with the drainage, and if it's a matter of fact, seeing it, that it's actually working, or if they want...
Yeah, nothing, like I said, nothing's changing, it still goes in the same pipes.
Oh, I bet when you...
I think, what, two extra catchways?
I bet when you repaved it, it did a tremendous amount of getting the water where it's supposed to go.
Yeah, it used to collect down near Brockton Avenue.
Yeah.
And now that's...
How did the catch basins get covered over to start with?
Originally, when Great Times was there, that's when I put the berm in the front there. The sign wasn't there. And when we dug the, I don't know if we did it, I don't think we did, because I would have seen it, but there was an old one out in the front next to where the telephone company had one. And it kept caving in, so we kept calling, and they kept saying, it's not us. Well, I said, you got to come out and see it. It says Bell Telephone on it, you know? So they finally came out, and they fixed it. And when we ripped out the parking lot, there was an old one there. So it was probably me that was, kept sinking. I kept calling them, because I saw the thing there. I didn't see what was underneath it. There was an old one underneath there, which connected, used to be a car wash.
An old catch basin?
That's right. And the car wash had one.
Before you ripped out?
Huh?
Before you owned it?
Yeah, before I owned it, yeah. Dick Robinson. And there was a catch basin out in the front. The water went into that. It came across to the other parking lot, and there was another catch basin. Then he had pipes from there that must have ran into that one. And then from there over to the other one, which was the hardware store. Do you remember the hardware store?
Yeah, I do.
It's terrible, yeah.
And that, you could drive right through. You can drive right through there. So there's two catch basins in the grass over there.
I think I remember puddles over by the hardware store, too.
Yeah.
Yeah. You had the supply place, you had the hardware store, and you had the car wash.
Exactly right. Yeah.
So all of those, when they were in operation and now that they're in operation, still collecting go the same way.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. Is there
it used to puddle. I mean, it used to fill up, and it was huge puddles out there.
Yeah.
It was a problem in the winter, you know.
Is there an imminent plan for the rest of the site in this corner?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. We were going to do, I have to come back to the, what?
Tell me.
Okay. We're going to build another building like that on the other side, so we would balance it off. But we have to go see the zoning board for that, and then... back to, I have to get a use variance on that. And that finishes off though, that would finish off the whole parking lot.
My concern moving forward is just making sure that everything gets pulled together.
Absolutely.
When it's finished.
Yeah.
So that it's not just kind of, it's a little piecemeal right now. It's made for 40 years, I get it.
Yeah.
But just making sure that all the apartment units and all the buildings and commercial uses and everything else, just it goes together, it looks nice.
If something is proposed there, we'd have to come back to you.
Hypothetically, if something was, that would be one of my requests.
Sorry, go ahead.
Well, that's all right.
One thing I did see that I just can't imagine grandfathering it is the parking spots being too small in this. They were 9 feet, but 9 feet is really difficult to get in and out of.
But if I don't know that. You know, I've looked around a lot of towns. Most of the towns do go with 9 feet. On some of the heavy users, like a Target, when there's a lot of in and out, opening doors, yeah, 10 feet works better. And a lot, like Target has it in their own specs that they're 10 feet wide. But like I said in my letter, you know, if it's 9 feet and someone seal coats their lot, you go back to striping it to 9 feet. You don't push it out to the 10 feet at that point.
Well, that didn't happen to me in Taunton. They had to go before the town to get it restriped.
Really?
Yeah. Because it was changing the pattern, changing the way it looked.
Oh, yeah, if you did a whole reconfiguration.
And it was a change of use.
Yeah.
So that caused the whole thing to be restriped. But physically, as long as it works, if you can back up and not hit anything, 9 feet, I don't know, would you go 10 feet? There's no more, you lose parking spot? I mean, obviously you lose parking spots, but you lose too many?
It's just right there.
We had a lot there.
The gym is very popular right now. I mean, if you drive by, you'll see it's very crowded. It's in the left-hand building there.
That's good.
And the aisle width is actually larger than what's required, so there is plenty of maneuverability in there. It works.
But no one's complained about the, you know, the width of the, you know.
No, well, they probably wouldn't, you know. When you're an immigrant, you keep your head down and you don't talk to anybody. That's the, you know, rock the boat. Okay, all right, if you guys, how do you feel?
I have a concern about taking out the island and putting in the stripes, particularly with some of the new stormwater protection rules that we're going to be having to adopt soon, that they're very pro swale, green space, something to get the water coming off that way.
I'm interested to see, we have the same problem out here in front of the town hall where some of the maple trees are just dying off. You know better than I, but someone told me because it's salt from the parking lot that contributes to it. I don't know, maybe they need a different species or something. I don't know what they're going to do, but obviously it's nice to try to incorporate that into projects that have some trees wherever you can.
Yeah, but a lot of these areas, you can see they're dug to, and it's got crap soil, you dug out a small area, put a tree in, and then it's
limited to it.
Yeah, it's limited.
The biggest thing that was when they repaved the entire lot for safety's sake, for aesthetics, but also they were able to find some topography. So the drainage is not better.
So you're concerned about setting precedent?
We have enough parking lots that are starting to push the limit on some of our rules. And I just, we need at some point to say no. There's a reason we have it in here, one, for stormwater, but two, aesthetics. And we don't want sea to shining sea of pavement from doorstep to doorstep. That's not...
Well, it's one of the discussions I've been having with a number of people about looking at that 9 foot versus 10 foot parking space rule, especially in residential uses, because the wider the space, the more pavement, the more drainage, the less greenery. So I think we, as a town, should consider how do we address that. You know, right now you need a variance with a new project to go from 10 to 9 feet. And maybe it shouldn't be a variance. Maybe it should be a special permit. Or maybe it should be allowed in the bylaw, rewritten, that it's a 9 foot space except for, you know, commercial uses or certain high volume commercial uses or whatever. Just something to consider. Nothing to discuss tonight. It's not on the table for town meeting. But in the past, that has been something that's been incorporated, especially into a lot of multifamily uses, to go with 9 foot spaces to allow slightly smaller parking lots.
And as a whole, the cars are getting smaller and smaller, other than some of the trucks, but the average car is, they don't make the town car anymore. They don't make any big Cadillacs anymore.
I mean, Dave Johnson brings up a good point with the angled parking spaces should be probably better defined, because the way that they're designated in the zoning bylaw, they don't really take into account an SUV, which might stick out some.
Recently had an engineer come in and draw parking spaces that nobody could park in, and I couldn't figure out how this engineer couldn't figure out that it didn't work, because it's right in the book.
Were they circles?
Huh?
Were they circles?
No, they were circles. It was the marijuana shop.
Oh, yeah.
But anyway, well.
Motion to approve.
Motion made to approve. Seconded?
Seconded.
Any further discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
So moved. Thanks for your time.
Don't go first.
Thank you for the work.
You know, I don't know where that changed, because almost all towns, they were trying to increase people using small, or giving people small cars benefits by putting small spaces close to the door.
Yeah.
And then you put the large, you have a few large ones, but not all of them. I don't know when that changed in the bylaws.
10 foot wide spaces.
We never had a mix.
Gone.
the request to release covenant on the...
I asked for a request to the board to take a vote to release the recorded covenant. The property label right now is 392 Randall Street, which was the Cabana's property. But what we're really discussing is the two-lot subdivision roadway that comes off of Dorsey Street, which currently is called English Place, or English Way. English Way. We are going to submit to you as a suggestion to change the name, because it does have to be changed, because there already was another roadway that was assigned that English Way. We have an idea, but I can't talk about it yet, because I haven't talked to the family that we have something in mind. So I will, we don't have to do that tonight. I can submit that to you at a later date. But in order to actually start, the covenant reads that you cannot start construction of the houses until the covenant is released. So I have submitted the release of covenant form, and typically what we do is post a bond for the roadwork, either cash or a performance bond. I don't think the estimate's been provided to you yet by PMT, which is fine. But instead of waiting another month, what I was asking the board is if they would take a vote to sign the covenant and for Liz or Wayne to hold it until PMT submits the dollar amount. Once the points of the dollar amount, they can fund the town, and then the release can be recorded at the registry of deeds. I also added specific language on the covenant that was a condition of the approval. If you recall, I was not part of that approval, nor was Mr. LaPointe. He bought it from the Cabana's. But basically, there was a condition about a swale being completed on Lot 2 for the protection of an abutting neighbor, and that had to be done before the property could be sold. So I included that in the written release, that condition is not being, is still in effect. So I'm just asking for a vote to authorize the board to sign it and to hold it until the bond is presented in accordance with whatever PMP's bond estimate is.
What's your pleasure?
So we don't have the dollar amount at this point?
Do you say when we might have it? Have you heard?
No.
He was out there today.
Are we...
He said he had gone out there last week, and you were putting in sewer, I think.
And we have the drainage in the street. We got permission from the town. They want to pave that road, so they gave us permission to do the excavating. So the drainage is in, the water's tapped and off the road, and the sewer's tapped and off the road. And we're going to put some binder down, finish off the road, and then we're off the road right now.
These are the two houses off Randolph?
Off of Dorsey Street. Yeah, so there's the house on Randolph Street.
That owned the property.
Right, which is technically Lot 1 on their plan, and then they sold Lot 2 and 3 in this new roadway.
Okay.
So Glenn's company owns Lot 2 and 3 in the new roadway. The two vacant lots. And that's all that the covenant applies to, and that's what this release would do.
So we have to come back at our next meeting to put a dollar figure into it?
No, your vote would be...
Oh.
To issue the release.
It would prevent them having to wait another month before we take a vote.
Right.
But it wouldn't be released until they came up with a bond, or whatever the figure is that PMP comes up with.
All right.
Hopefully, it will be within a week or so, but we have to wait.
Yeah, he requested the decision letter and a bunch of other stuff, which you got all of that last week.
Yeah.
I don't have a problem with that, as long as we're holding the covenant until...
So someone make a motion?
I'll make it.
Motion made.
Seconded.
Seconded. Any further discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
This is the form right here. Just want to pass it, Liz can hold it. Thank you. And Liz, you just let me know, receive something, and we'll get the money to you.
Okay.
You gonna have to notarize this or anything?
Yes, I will, but I'm not leaving. No, I should, you should agree.
Proposed zoning bylaw changes.
Rick, I gave him a copy of what you sent me.
Thank you.
And because I wasn't here last month, I just wanted to affirm, before I send an ad to the newspaper, what we're moving forward with. And I sent that to you. Dan had some corrected language. which I also believe you got.
These included both, we kind of had two sets in front of us last time, and these include...
So there were 12, originally 12, proposed changes. Nine, sorry. Two of them were about the solar equipment.
Yep.
And according to the minutes I had, you voted not to move forward with those two.
Okay.
I believe there was some conversation about the pool definition, and I did reach out to the building inspector. I attached his response.
Which is basically, it's already part of the building code. Was that from Dan?
That was from Dan. Marshall said because there is no definition for a swimming pool. 175-26A says excluding swimming pools. 75-4 definition structures mentioned swimming pools. There is no definition for swimming pools. I think there should be. Because Dan had sent back that he didn't think you needed a definition for swimming pools because it was covered in the building code.
Yeah, which makes sense.
And then I asked Marshall why he had submitted it, and because it's not in our zoning bylaw.
If we don't reference a master set of definitions, it's kind of hard for anybody to go there. So we'd have to somewhere you have to refer to look at the Massachusetts code for definition.
Sure, it says that. I don't know.
Oh, okay.
I don't know if it does either. I have no idea if it refers to the building code.
It would be in our definitions.
So I think according to Dan anyway, the issue was spas and hot tubs, which were included in the revised definition for swimming pool. It included them.
Yes, once again, we've asked for a sufficient explanation. Preferably, he'd come here in person, and we've instead gotten kind of a...
Well, I didn't ask him to come in person because nobody asked me to do that. Okay. I did reach out to him for an explanation, so him not being here is not on him. Okay. That's because nobody told me to ask him, because okay. I certainly would have.
Previous years of him not showing up are on him, though.
Yep, but...
But I'm getting very frustrated with our building inspector. We ask for explanations and we get half sentences in emails that doesn't explain what the issue is. And I don't know why we're talking about hot tubs and swimming pools in the same sentence.
Does that have anything to do with the building code, Bob?
Again, it's anything 24 inches or over, so that would... I mean, technically, that includes the hot tubs.
But I do believe hot tubs or jacuzzis or whatever you call it are specifically excluded, like from fencing regulations for swimming pools. So I think that was one of the concerns, which right. Rick and I both had mentioned last meeting, that if you were to adopt that swimming pool definition as presented, which included hot tubs and swimming pools, did you then absorb new fencing regulations that people have to put fences around their hot tubs? That was a problem. I think that's when we look for clarity of that, because if that's the case, now we have a conflict.
I think there's also a requirement that swimming pools have to be a certain distance away from the building, from the house.
Right.
Yeah, they collapse.
And you have to have alarms on your door.
Right. Now you're telling people who have a hot tub 5 feet off their porch, you can't do that anymore. It has to be 10 to 15 feet away from the house, which...
Well, you got them inside the house, too.
Yeah. So,
do your zoning book.
Mm-hmm. I have the zoning book.
As I understand, that is not moving forward with the swimming pool bylaw.
No. Well, the definition you want.
Yeah.
So we're not moving forward on that, is that the...
I have the zoning book, which I always bring to the meeting.
It's covered in the building code.
Yeah.
You know, so I don't know where his lack of... Very extensively covered in the building code, I don't know why it needs to be in there. He can't hear you.
Yes, sir.
I asked Liz for a copy, I think, of what we were discussing tonight with the zoning bylaws. I'm sorry, I lost track, is this the hearing about the zoning law change?
No, we're just setting up what the hearing's gonna say, or what the...
Okay, which articles will go to a hearing?
Right.
Okay.
And also cleaning them up a little bit.
Great.
So do we include this in, give them a chance to clean it up a little bit, or we just nixed it?
Your pleasure.
I don't know, it seems like we just nixed it, it seems...
Are we gonna go ahead with this and have it, and have a hearing on it, or we're not gonna put it on the warrant?
Well, can we refer to the building code for a definition, can we do that?
Refer to the building code?
Yeah.
To say that?
I don't know if we can, but that would make sense.
Why not, right?
Well, that'd be what I meant, yeah, so right in, so you put on the definitions where it says that, C elsewhere to...
CP building code.
Massachusetts building code.
Building code.
Yep, so you can clean it up like that, if he's got a problem with it, he can come in and, at the public hearing and...
Right.
So you want me to strike, this includes in-ground, above-ground, and on-ground swimming pools, hot tubs, and spa, and say, please, C?
Definition for swimming pools, C, yep.
And just to clarify, this is Article 175-4.
Right. So there it's on the public hearing, if there's something wrong with that, he can come in and explain it.
No, I agree, it would be good to get clarification from the building inspector.
Yeah, I mean, it is part of the building code, and it's extensively part of the building code, so...
We concern ourselves with this book, not the building code, like that.
Could I offer a suggestion to the street address on the sign proposal?
Could we just go through them like in order, just to...
Thanks.
Yeah, I'm not quite sure what the order is, because I got three different ones here, so...
Because we've already blown past that.
I have the master one, so...
I think that's what I got from tonight.
So you voted to keep the sign one, right?
I'm sorry?
The address on the sign one, because that's actually the first one on my list, my original list. I think Dan deleted some when he...
Switch a minus here. Second page on the bottom.
Did you guys see this thing from Dan Crane?
Oh, there it is.
Did you see the thing from Dan, going back to swimming pool? Did you guys...
Starts off with swimming pool, right?
Right.
That was from Dan.
Right.
Yes.
And he talks about what the building code says.
Right, which is just a little snippet, but still.
All right, so swimming pool.
It's actually...
And then 175-32I-9B, is that the next one you guys have?
First one I have is...
175-32D-4.
Yeah, I have dimensional requirements.
Dimension requirements?
Yep.
All right, want to do that?
Yep.
D, and then 4 changes from 50 feet apart in the event of a variance for more than one building on a lot is granted by the zoning board of appeals, and that's being changed to 50 feet from any other residential building granted for the site.
So that's garages, maintenance sheds, closer to the building than currently allowed.
It says residential building, right?
Right, so that would mean that if you have a four-building development, that the residential buildings still have to be 50 feet apart, but a garage, shed, outhouse, can be closer.
Yeah, that would be a...
The reason this was suggested was because of the word variance in D4, because it conflicted. The purpose, this section 32D was revised a number of years ago over if you had 12 units or more, you had to, it would come, this section would kick in. But it, there's another part of the bylaw that says you can only have one principal building on a lot. And it says, except for apartment condominiums and all. So the mention of the word variance in this section almost implied that you had to get a variance to have one, more than one building on a lot if you wanted a condo or apartment. There was always this kind of conflict. So we were just trying to simply say, keep with the original intent of number four, is the buildings have to be 50 feet apart. You don't have to mention the word variance because it already says you don't need one in an earlier section which talks about the number of principal buildings on a lot. That's all it was really trying to do. But to your point, Rick, yeah, an accessory building, much like a single-family house, it, that doesn't apply. It's really keeping the residences apart from each other.
Are we all set with that?
Mm-hmm.
Yep. So I want to make a motion?
To add it to the public hearing?
For the public hearing,
yes.
Yeah.
Motion made.
And seconded.
Second.
Any further discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
So moved. And then the next article will be 175-58. To add E, all freestanding signs.
There's one before that.
Yep.
175-39.
Is it? Is that changing anything or that's just...
It's reducing the track size,
yes,
required from 10 acres to 3 acres.
Oh, from 10 to 3 acres, right, yeah. Do you want me to read it or you all have it in front of you?
No, we have it in front of us.
Motion to add it to the public hearing.
Second.
Any good?
Sorry. I agree with this. This is the Muppet District, which is up off of Chestnut Street, essentially. I think there's a part of it up near Coltar. The other concern was the 200 feet of frontage requirement. Although you might be able to find a piece with a good amount of backland, it's hard to find a piece with 200 feet of frontage. So if you don't, there's no grandfathering provisions for a commercial development like there is if you had an old residential lot, you could have a grandfathered piece of frontage. But with a commercial lot, in fact, I'm going to the zoning board this month for a 28-acre parcel of land that has 98 feet of frontage. We need a variance in the Muppet District. It's just a thought, if the board wanted to consider going from 200 to 100, it might allow more of the development that you're intending in that area, which is typically a driveway going through that 100-foot development.
Good.
Just a thought, if you, the 3 acres is a good idea, but I think the 100 acres kind of makes it a little bit more workable, but still requires a pretty good chunk of frontage for a driveway.
Could you leave it as a special permit? Could you leave it as a special permit?
You
to decrease it?
A special permit.
Huh?
You'd have to say that it could be granted by special permit. This is setting the minimum better. And whatever, if you can't achieve the minimum, you need to get a variance from the zoning board.
Well, I mean, the commercial property from residential is very different. I mean, residential, no one really likes to have a house pop up behind them. And so they get, having two tiny little frontage. But in these, I would expect to think the width would be, you plan, have enough width so you have an in driveway, an out driveway, a place for the sign, setbacks, green space, because they don't really need to be on the street. They just need access to their site.
That's kind of why I was suggesting as a special permit, if they could demonstrate.
And I agree with
just
you. So you don't need 200 feet of frontage for
right.
The way you're talking. 100 feet, yeah, that should suffice. If you have 90, whatever, you can go to the zoning board. If you have more than that, then fine. But you're right. The frontage usually doesn't get utilized for building purposes.
Yeah.
It allows you to get to the back acreage, which Chestnut Street is mostly back acreage.
Yeah.
Is this something that we're putting out there as the planning board, or did someone suggest this to us to have... to put this on?
Was this the review that Dan did mostly? Liz?
Yes.
And went to all the other boards and everything else. I think this is Dan's.
Oh, so he pulled this out as to...
You're making me go into the crypt.
Sorry.
For the sake of the public hearing, if we want to consider that, it has to be in there?
I think if it's anything major, you would. If it's just weird, that's another thing.
I would prefer going as a special permit versus trying to add it later, yeah.
But if we don't put that in there now, we can't bring it up at the public hearing? The language?
I think you could. I think you could change that.
I'm not sure.
You're not sure on that?
Because we're narrowing it or...
Adding that.
It depends on how it gets advertised. I'm actually going to have them draft the ad because it always is less words.
The best thing would be to have it...
But if that's the only thing, if you only put in the acreage, then I don't know if you can amend the frontage piece because if it wasn't advertised, somebody who might have been...
Right.
Curious about the frontage could have come if it was included and they didn't come because it was just about the acreage.
Right. I think you're right. So especially whatever goes to town meeting cannot be enlarged or expanded. It can be shrunk for zoning purposes. To your point, what I might suggest is if you were going to put this to a public hearing, you would simply, to address your thought, at the end of the first sentence, the tract shall be single consolidated ownership at the time of the application shall be at least 3 acres in size with a minimum of 200 feet of frontage unless otherwise approved by special permit by the planning board. That's all you have to put in there.
That's kind of what I was looking for. We might have some people from the zoning board with their feelings hurt, but...
Can you read that again to me?
Unless otherwise allowed by special permit from the planning board.
And then at least we can tweak...
That would set the minimum at 3 acres and 200 feet.
Right, then we could tweak it a little at the special, if we had to. I'm thinking it should be a special permit.
Because it has to come to your board with site plan review regardless.
And I think if it gets advertised that way, and if you want to take it back later on, you could do that.
Yeah, I prefer to have it in, right.
Okay.
I'll make that as a motion.
As amended, right?
Yep.
So you're all set with that? Someone want to make a motion?
Make the motion.
Seconded. Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Someone? You got that, right?
Yep.
And then to see if the town will vote to amend 17558 general regulations and add the following E, all freestanding signs identifying the property are required to have the physical street address on them to aid public safety agents in time of an emergency.
Mr. Chairman?
Please.
Can I ask?
Sure.
Again, can I look this up for you, Liz? I think this is a great idea. The fire chief, I think, was one of the proponents of this.
Right.
So, for example, Lowe's sign underneath it would say, I don't know the address, 400 Bedford Street. So a passerby can say, there's an accident at 400 Bedford Street. The only thing I wanted to clarify was to add a line that says, said street address may be a separate, actually, if Liz could write, I amended it.
Said street address may be part of or separate from the sign and shall not be included in the calculation of the sign's area.
Yeah, that makes sense. It'd be part of the sign board almost.
Right, so some people have it as a separate sign underneath the Lowe's sign, for example. Some people incorporate it in their business sign. But because there's a restriction on the size of the sign, it shouldn't be taken away from the business. So that was all that says. The address should be on there, but it doesn't count towards the 32 square feet that they're allowed to have, as an example.
No problem adding that regarding the calculations of the sign, providing that we're not also then changing any visibility. That, you know, they put a little drop piece on the bottom of it, and that starts cutting the visibility.
Or the sight line.
Or the sight line, that's what, yeah.
Still have to be 10 feet high or whatever it is.
Yeah. Or it could be right on the building someplace.
No, this only applies to freestanding signs.
Oh, for freestanding.
They can still put the advertisement.
I'll make that as a motion.
Seconded. Any further discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Do you want me to add and cannot obstruct sight lines?
Yes, please. back to the swimming pools.
The correct reference for that swimming pool definition is to look into the International Building Code, because we don't really have a code anymore in Massachusetts, and it refers to that.
Actually, Jan made a reference to it.
Swimming pool we took care of already, right?
No.
And then the next article, to see if the town will vote to amend 175-4 definitions and word uses by adding the following. That's the same thing.
I don't know if we actually voted on that swimming pool, did we?
You did not.
The swimming pool one before it. Make it as a motion, what we talked about.
Which one's that?
The swimming pool one. We didn't take a vote.
What are we going to do with that?
Refer to the building code.
Oh, we didn't take a vote on it?
No.
Okay.
Refer to the building code, and if Marshall wants to come in and change it, he can. At least it's there for the public hearing.
So the motion is just that?
For the definition.
Motion made, seconded?
Second.
Seconded. Any further discussion?
Aye.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
So moved. See if the town will vote to amend 175-132 I 9B as follows. Let me read all that.
All it does is insert the parenthetical phrase.
B, right?
Just the parentheses, an annual in-law affidavit, that's the only change. They inserted the name of the affidavit.
So this requires, currently, if you have an in-law apartment, do you need to submit anything annually regarding who's living?
You're supposed to.
Yes.
Supposed to.
But I think all depends when the in-law apartment was created.
Okay.
But he's put an annual in-law affidavit.
Okay. Him being the building inspector?
Right.
Do we know if this is needed for some specific reason? I'm not opposed to it.
It's probably an illegal thing with an affidavit.
There was something in there before, wasn't there?
There's always been a requirement.
Yeah.
For any in-law apartment that was created after the bylaw, they had to file an annual statement every year to confirm that there was a relative in the in-law apartment, that it wasn't being used as a two-family. The only thing I see is that they're just putting in the name of the notarized statement. They're calling it an annual in-law affidavit. It just seems like a waste of a zoning article to do that. But
I think what he's probably saying is he hasn't got some kind of a form that he wants to have for some reason.
He can do. I just don't think he has to change the zoning article.
Or is this related to some other regulation elsewhere that this is then redirecting people to say that no? When we say notarized statement, we're talking about the annual in-law affidavit, which is referenced in this over here.
It's a tough regulation. I mean, to get even to remember to do it. I mean, one of the ideas with it is, you see, someone moving in and a residential house suddenly has 18 cars and it's parked all over the side of the house. And then the other part of that is the fire department rushing to something where he thinks it's just a single family and there's all these people in there. But seems more like a revenue maker than, you know,
The problem with it has been, and the reason this thing all originated, is that people would have in-law apartments and the in-laws would move out and people would move in. We had one in my neighborhood, and all of a sudden it becomes a two-family. And that's what they're trying to avoid.
I think that was the intent of the in-law bylaw when we first drafted it.
Right, and the problem with it is if they don't. Oh, I didn't know. But when they have to file every year, and if the building department doesn't get a filing,
and that comes up, for example, mine is prior to this bylaw, the building inspector made me put it on my deed, basically that language that it was an in-law. So when you go look at my deed in the registry of deeds, that's part of it. So I assume once you do an in-law, it's part of you. Should be, it might not be.
The special permit gets recorded at the registry deeds, but honestly, as a real estate attorney, I'll see it, but a buyer won't.
Right.
So it just becomes, I mean, in an in-law apartment, it's constructed slightly differently, where it has to have direct access into the main house, whereas a two-family is separate.
Right.
I don't have any problem with the bylaw. It worked. I mean, people should file this affidavit. I was just questioning, why did they bother to spend the time to just put the name of the affidavit in there? Maybe there is a reason. I don't know what it is.
The notarized statement piece.
It already says they have to file a notarized statement. They just said, and it's called an in-law affidavit.
For the sake of argument, can we leave that in there for the public hearing if he wants to come in and defend it.
Otherwise,
we can take it out.
Right, you can always recommend not to approve.
What does the board also say about, right now, it's just that the people who own it have to come and give something to the town. That's assuming that people realize they have to do this. Do we want to at least at some point say?
They should get a letter.
You should get a letter from.
When I worked down there, we used to send a letter out to them at the beginning of the year saying, with the form, saying, fill it out and return it to us.
So if we don't get an explanation, we'll just take it out.
All right, so you want me to reach out to him for an explanation of why he wants that? Okey-dokey.
So on the motion, we'll.
Give him the benefit of the doubt to leave it in there.
Motion made and seconded. Any further discussion?
Aye.
All those in favor?
Aye.
To be clear, my preference would be that he shows up and explains in person so we can have, ask questions and have a dialogue.
The next one is changing from 50-foot to 100-foot on the maximum distance.
Do we know the background of this again? Who?
Sean probably can.
I do. There didn't used to be a limit. The bylaw used to say that if you had a larger parcel that had two different zoning districts in it, you could apply the zoning regulations of the larger portion to the rest, to the remainder of it. So, for example, when Walmart came in, the front majority of the property was in the highway commercial zone, the very rear was in the residential zone. And they were able to say basically that that parcel was highway commercial, were able to develop it as done. A number of years ago, it was put in, it said that that line, that zoning district line, you could only as a right move at 50 feet. And if you still had more land that was, like in this case, residential, you'd have to go to the zoning board to get a use variance to allow you to develop it commercially. That 50 feet, it's not a lot. It's, you know, not even the length of this room. So I had talked to Dan about this. We were trying to talk about how to kind of encourage commercial growth but still have a little controls over it. The thought was make that 100 feet. If it's just, if it's an expansion up to 100 feet, okay, you don't need to go to the experience. You still need site plan review and everything else. If it's more than 100 feet, then you'd have to get the additional variance.
And it's still the bigger parcel.
Variance or special approval? Special permit?
Typically, it's a variance. Depending what the zoning districts are and what you're proposing to do, but typically it comes when you're doing a commercial project and part of your land is residential. Sometimes the reverse is true. If the entrance is residential and you're trying to get to a commercial parcel out back, you need a variance to drive over that residential because your commercial driveway is considered a commercial use. So in that regard, you would try to move the 100-foot line to the street.
I would make a motion to add it. We can have some more discussion then, if you would like.
Second. Any further discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
See if the town will vote to delete the note in 175-21, Table of Regulations G, which states note 1, solid waste facilities are prohibited in the technology business district.
I threw this in because I threw it in because we don't have any technology business district.
Yep, it's a little longer.
We don't have a technology.
No.
So you want to just eliminate this?
Yep. It refers to nothing.
As long as we're clear that this isn't opening up the door for anything.
Well, I don't know what. I don't know.
Right. It's just getting rid of it out of the technology business.
The technology businesses, which we had, which was what they had the recall about and everything else.
Right.
We could just say it was a clarification.
So it doesn't exist anyway, so what?
We could just say it was a clarification of language. It's just something.
I mean, if you want to change it to business development district, I don't care about that. It doesn't refer to anything that exists anymore.
Yeah, I mean, that's all we have to
do. No, just as long as we're not opening up a door here where all this.
For a solid waste facility?
Yes.
The best thing that ever happened.
It would be, but.
Not fighting that battle.
I don't know about that.
Yeah, it doesn't change the use chart itself. This is just an extra.
Make the motion to put it on the public hearing.
Second?
Second.
Any further discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
So moved. Let's see if the town will vote to add the following language, 175-77, site plan review, new section D and E. D says design field changes during the course of construction if conditions necessitate. the alteration of an, of the approved plan, the applicant must notify the planning board in writing and must have the design change, which is approved and incorporated into an amended plan, which will require approval of the, by the board. Failure to do so will result in penalties as outlined in section E. Penalties, any failure to build in accordance with the approved plan shall be subject to a penalty determined by the board commensurate with a need to mitigate the extent of the failure of the applicant to build the project according to the approved plan or to have the applicant completely remove the unapproved work.
So as of right now, we don't have recourse when someone comes in with a site plan or as-built that is completely...
Other than removal, we do have that. But the problem that it is when the building is 2 feet bigger than what it's supposed to be, hard to do it.
So with the penalty, I have a concern about with the term mitigate the extent of the failure. Just thinking about the real life situation we have, I'm not sure what that gives us the ability to do, because we aren't, can't mitigate a building that's 3 feet too wide. Or,
well, we could tell them to take it down.
Well, yeah, but again, yeah, but
we don't want to do that.
But I want to have a penalty, but I don't know how we mitigate the extent of that failure when it's something like that. Not opposed to having some sort of teeth in here, but I don't know if this accomplishes what we need it to.
I mean, at some point, you could hold up the occupancy permit if he's still, if we're still signing them.
But again, if you think about the place on Adams Street that had all those changes, they're not going to take anything down. We're not. Yeah. So I don't know how we mitigate the extent of that failure.
Yes, Sean.
There already is language in your zoning bylaw in section 80 and 81. 80 is called enforcement, and 81 is called violations and penalties. It actually says that the selectmen through the building inspector are in charge of enforcement of the zoning bylaw, of which site plan review is a zoning bylaw. And you can have penalties for fines up to $300 a day for the ongoing violation. In a perfect world, and what is happening much more often now is once a site plan is approved, a building permit is issued, an as-built foundation plan is usually submitted. And that's a chance for the building department to kind of compare the foundation to the site plan to make sure that they're starting in the right place. Many times they even do that with single family homes to make sure there's no setback violations. So I don't mean to dump this on the building department because they have a lot of work on their own, but that is the first line of defense, quote unquote. I really don't like the wording of what's proposed here because there are always changes on site due to, you know, whether it's the school itself or whether it's just a duplex, is always changes. And the way it's wording it, basically it says any design changes must be approved by an amendment plan approved by the planning board. Essentially you'd be telling them stop construction, get a plan drawn up, file it, wait for the next meeting after that, get a vote, and then go back and continue construction. That would create havoc in the commercial lending and the commercial construction industry. If you strongly felt that you needed to enact something else, then I think you need to go back to the day where a contract, let's say Glenn, would call an appointed board member to say, can you come down to the site and look at this? We got an issue. We hit some ledge. We need to move the retaining wall 3 feet. We need to move the building over 2 feet. Doesn't violate zoning. We're just moving things. Can you give us the okay so we can still keep moving? Since you guys meet once a month, it just doesn't work out in the real world to have to come back to the board for a vote.
Yeah, I speaking on behalf of that, I have been that guy over the years that has gone out there and said, yes, that's okay. And then I've come back to the board and the board has take the rattan out on me. So, and I think that's why we really, you know, I know Bob, when Bob was building inspector, called me out on a couple of things. And, you know, I listened to what Bob had to say, and to hold something up really wasn't necessary. And obviously, if I get out there and the building inspector said, I don't approve of this, I certainly wouldn't override the building inspector. And but that's where the problem has come in. And they do have to wait another month.
I did also look at the bylaws of Norwell, Rockland, Hanover. Hanover's was very difficult, it's like Boston, because they have a commercial development. But I couldn't find anything that says what this is trying to do. Pretty much relies on the same type of building inspector. I mean, perhaps one issue is somehow we incorporate that upon site plan approval, one of the conditions would be that an as-built foundation plan gets submitted to this board. So at some point, you guys can also compare apples to apples and try to catch something. But that's just getting the building, but a lot of times...
It's not just the building, it's other things, it's piping and...
Fences and all sorts of things.
A walkway, you know, and some of the stuff is minimal, or sometimes you think this is better than what we thought. The engineer didn't think it out, the contractor knows better. So, you know, I think there has to be a threshold of even, you know, right now it is, you know, minor deviations from site plans and major deviations. You have to come back with a vote for some sort of major deviation. Where is that line?
So we usually don't see much of this until the final as-built plan comes in, and it should be Katie by the door, and that's the problem.
Yeah.
And I know that's...
That's why we started with the bonds.
That's right. That's correct.
Without mentioning any names, particular projects.
When does the notice have to go out for the hearing?
For a meeting?
Yeah, when we're putting the notice up for the hearing.
It's gonna run the... We're meeting the 13th, right? So it'll be the first Monday in April and the last Monday in March.
Would it be possible, do we have the time, if we ask town council to say, what are other towns? What's the best practice now for...
Didn't we do that?
Planning boards to say, hey, we need to put some teeth in there.
No, we had Dan do it.
Oh.
This is what Dan came up with.
It's a good effort, but I wouldn't mind seeing if there's another best practice that maybe we could...
So do you want to leave this in, and in the meantime, have town council give us some kind of an direction on it, or you want to eliminate it?
For the sake of public hearing, we could leave it in and discuss it further. We can always nix it then.
All right.
We should discuss it more.
So get a motion to put it on the warrant made and seconded it. And then we'll, by the time we have the hearing, we'll have a town council review it. All right?
There is no easy solution to this.
No.
And we've been there. I mean, we tried with the bond.
Unless you guys meet weekly, I'm sorry.
Yeah, we're not doing that.
Well, kind of like what I suggested. Well, I don't think it's uncommon. But as long as someone's keeping record of it, so that if something happens during the week, it's not going to happen immediately. Say, have the engineer draw that up and send a copy over to the, or give it to the building inspector. So you don't want to surprise the building inspector.
And maybe you put it back on the town's engineer to say it's a minor change. Go ahead.
Yeah, we
have
stuff.
Yeah, we got a lot.
I'll also point out that Abington PMP is prior owner of PMP, kind of morphed the procedure where the Abington's engineer is inspecting private commercial developments, drainage installations. The bylaw and most other town bylaws just say that it shall be certified as built by the design engineer. So let's use a person. If Russ Wheatley designed it, Russ Wheatley certifies that he saw that it was installed as it was designed. Abington's one of the few towns I know that has been including a requirement, much to my objection, that the town's engineer also, we're paying two engineers to look at the same hole. And I don't know if that's a good thing. Well, I don't think it's a good thing. Sometimes it's a little bit of overkill.
I guess I'm kind of suggesting that if, obviously stuff happens when you're building, if it's a minor change and it's approved by the town's engineer, something prior to, I mean, he's better off qualified to say it's just a minor change.
I agree.
Go ahead and do it.
We're trying to do that more often now because of this reason. Yeah. As an example, on Center Avenue, we built the condos. The design was to have curbing that curved at the driveway, but all of the other curves along the sidewalk were angular, and the sidewalk was ADA compatible. We asked for him to come out and look at it, and he gave us a waiver. We put that in writing and just submitted it as part of the record. That's why that would be changed. Documentation.
Unfortunately, there's a cost to it, but I think he's better qualified to say it's a minor change.
There's very few instances where he isn't, they're not commenting on something. And it all sounds to be like you're using the wrong chart. You guys are supposed to be using this chart. That's what seems to be a lot of pointing out to be.
There's nothing here.
I don't know. I've in the last year or so, I've really lost confidence in the engineers that have come before us. And it's kind of like, well, we'll see when our engineer actually looks at it and see if you really got it. But I'm not sure how to, that's that thing, is you can't really judge who, if it's right. We're not in a position to second guess anything.
I agree.
Something has changed here, but we did ask them at one point, look, when you get to a point when you've got a list going off a page, and now these are all the things that stop the inspection, and stop the reviewing, and let's bring this back to the developer or the engineer. Well,
and hence, one particular engineer that we're not really using anymore, it seems to be less and less with the newer engineers.
This is a good argument to hire a town plan.
Yes.
This is truly...
Town engineer.
This discuss, or a town engineer.
Yeah.
Because a lot of communities have both.
And then you can contact immediately.
We have consent for you guys and for the contractors.
I'll say this on television. I hope in my time on the board, and I've got a couple of years left, I hope the town does the right thing and hire a town planner and a town engineer.
Wonderful to help coordinate the development of this town.
Because communities smaller than us have both.
Yep.
And it's not that we're not capable as a board, but we're not engineers on this board. I'm a professional planner, but we need help.
Unfortunately, we had one, and then when the economy tanked, we lost them.
So if it does move forward, we will be there to object to it, but nothing personal, just...
No.
It's just business.
It opens the door to change it if it's on there.
Yeah, you can recommend it not be approved.
Okay, now, have you got a copy of this? What, from Dan?
Yeah.
I haven't read it myself. This is on the repeal of 17565 and replacement with the following. You want me to read it, or you want to?
This is in regard to the conversations we've had about street trees.
Yes.
And how we can better do this.
Oh, I haven't seen this.
That's okay.
Oh, this came from you?
Yes.
Not Dan. Came from Rick.
So the idea is a couple different things, that with the new stormwater runoff protection regs, there's going to be more focus on restricting clear cutting as much as possible. So the first section is just, it's kind of restating what we already have, which is about making sure that we're keeping big trees in place, from not cutting down this word here. Preserving foliage to the maximum extent possible, except areas where construction activity would be taking place. I've added language that says trees greater than 8 inches in diameter shall be indicated on project documents, just so we know what we're talking about. And we can argue about that if you want. But then the next part is, I think the current one is they have to have 4 trees per housing unit is the current.
Three street trees per lot in a line.
Right. So this is the ratio of one tree for every 3 trees of 8 inches or greater removed. You have to replant at a minimum mature height of 20 feet in height. And the other part is to give more landscaping options, so that if we don't want to do the street tree option, that you can use basically plant additional trees either in side yards, in the front yards, make it part of a greater landscaping, but the trees itself would be larger, greater trees to help create more of the canopy look, getting away from the 20-foot pears and pin oaks and whatnot. So I think it gives a little bit more flexibility. You can still do street trees. Instead of doing every 40 feet, you could do, if you want to do a taller tree, you can do it every 70 feet, and then you're planting less trees, but they're higher and they have bigger canopy. I think this gives some flexibility, and if it's too much to talk about now, we can hold this off next time, but it's more just a place to start a conversation. I think that the first part of this is basically, the reason we're even talking about this is because we want to make sure we're protecting the green canopy of the town. It was called out in our master plan that we actually are doing a pretty good job protecting the canopy compared to some other towns.
Did you pull this from somewhere, or did you?
No,
it's all yours.
Ramblings. That we're going to be having, we just got a grant to help mitigate the town's impacts on climate change. And one thing is, you know, making sure we have lots of trees. And we want to make sure we're keeping the Abington's roadways visually appealing. And we have these new stormwater, I don't think I got the acronym correct, stormwater protection regulations that we need to kind of take into consideration. So all that's kind of lumped into this potential change. And I'm not wed to all of it, and I'll give Sean, if you'd like a copy of it, I can provide it to you later.
I'd love to have a copy. I think it's great. I love the idea of the option of like more of a natural tree layout instead of a line. And some trees may look great with the lines trees, and some might be great when you spread them out. Do you have any, like a list of recommended trees?
And that's in here, is that there would be a list of acceptable varieties in the office. Oh, that's the other point, is that we would require at least three varieties of appropriate species, so that we're not just planting the same type of tree all the way down the street, which is.
And what's interesting too is like the bylaw right now says three trees per lot. It doesn't talk about different sized lots. You know, if you try to put three trees along the muster field along the street, you can't fit them. You know, and if you had a 200 foot wide lot, you have three trees. So maybe we can come up with something. More.
This is pretty good happening. I mean, actually, I think 40 feet is kind of close, but
well,
it does 40 feet spread them out.
40, depending on what kind of tree. I mean, that's 40 feet, so it's 20 feet on either side of the tree. So, although, yeah, because it's 40 feet, so the tree is going to have there's 40 feet of tree.
Touching each other.
And then another 40 feet of tree. It's not, they're not encroaching on each other.
If you plant a tree in the middle of this room, you're not going to have another tree before you get to the walls of this room.
And it's tricky too because.
Well, it depends on what kind of tree it is.
Back in the day, you didn't have to worry about where the sewer line was because everyone had septic. You know, they selected the trees. So if you plant a tree now near the street, you've got to be careful where the electric, water, and sewer lines are and where the driveway is. You can't put a tree within 10 or 15 feet of a driveway because the roots will end up getting under it. So there's got to be a way for us to write it. I started looking at other towns. I love it. I did have a question directly related to that regarding calipers. If it's inappropriate, let me know. I know you can't vote on it tonight because it's not on the agenda, but up in Century Estates, remember we had the delivery of the wrong tree, so we had to get the pin oaks, which we're going to get. But to buy a 3.5-inch pin oak, it's a much bigger ball. So the tree company said, I delivered all 50 pear trees in one truck. To get the 50 pin oaks, you're gonna need two to perhaps three trucks. It's not the price of the tree that's the issue, it's the delivery fee.
Well, it's the dig into the hole and everything else that goes with it, what you need to lift it up with and everything.
So the gentleman, the tree guy said, why are you asking for 3.5? Nobody asks for 3.5, everyone does 2.5, 2 inches, and most towns don't do 3.5. It's a.
Well, some people do.
But the question
12
was.
12 inches off the ground, and some do a DBH.
Unless you tell me I'm out of my mind, I'd like to ask for it to be on the next agenda if we could get a waiver to the 3.5 requirement for the pin oak tree so we can get those trees ordered. 2.5 is fine, or something larger than 2.5. We'd like to get those up here and installed as soon as possible, and I can get them all delivered together. So I'll try that.
So one other note on this is requiring developers to map out where these larger trees are. Before anyone says that it seems like a hardship, currently we require, I think it's 4-inch trees to be identified. So we never see them, but it's part of our current bylaws. So the idea is that if we make this a definite thing, they have to do identify what the great trees are and whatever lot clearing out, that they have to identify less of them, but at least we need to definitely see where they're going to be, just so we are aware of what's up there. Other towns have that sort of
thing. I know they do, but there are a whole mess of situations. One, if the grade changes, the trees die, In some cases, it does, they don't, but quite often they do. The other problem is we all see when we have a windstorm and this tree lands on the house, in most cases, a tree that landed on the house should have been taken down long before, because it's rotted and everything else. Sometimes they come up right with the roots and everything, and that's a different situation. But it's, I guess when you put it in, on a piece of paper, it's very difficult. If some people went out and looked at a lot, they'd make a determination and say, yeah, take that one down and this one down, and the grade's going to change, and the water table's going to change, and whatever.
It's situational.
There's a lot of things that go into this, yeah.
I know the one place in town, they did it, I don't know, it was very successful, they mapped it out. The luxury, they always advertise, the luxury apartments, they advertise on Subway Galley.
The Woodlands?
One down.
It's off of Summer Street, yeah.
They did a massive mapping of all the existing trees there were, and they did a walking trail and everything.
But that was a nursery to begin with.
Oh, is that what?
Yeah.
That was a nursery land, and those were all trees that could be dug and moved. So that is a little different situation than when you go into a wooded area. It really wasn't a wooded area. I mean, it was wooded area, but.
They did do a good job of saving a lot of trees.
That was a 40B development too, you know.
Huh?
That was a 40B development.
Yeah, I know. Partially under.
I always remind people of that.
I was building inspector.
I don't see any, I don't know, I think it's worth talking about, eight, I mean, 4 inch, that's a weed.
That's just it, it's a juvenile tree, or some of them.
Yeah, and I think you had some language in there also, that if you ended up removing some of those trees, then you had to replace them, which many times is probably the right thing to do, because if you're changing grades. The other thing we've noticed in projects, especially up at Century Estates, when you have an existing tree forest of 60-foot tall trees, and you cut it back, the trees that are now on the edge of the forest are likely to get to fall over, because they're used to being supported by surrounding trees, and now they're exposed. And we had that, in fact, in my own house lot, we cleared it and waded through the winter and let the trees fall, and then went back in and kind of cleaned up a bit. So it's always going to be an issue to deal with, but I like the idea.
What do you want to do?
I'd like to include it for discussion, but.
Yeah. Is that a subdivision regulation?
No, it's something.
Yeah.
Kept up in the mind.
200-19.
Aye.
Or not 19, different one. Thanks.
Yeah, I would include it for the sake of discussion, we can always.
I'd second that.
Motion made and seconded, any further discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Okay, and then you'll have the stormwater management bylaw, which town council currently has.
Who's going to explain that one?
Thank you.
We can actually have the engineer down.
Yeah, that's going to be we need a handout or something so people understand it, because that's going to be a long one.
Yep.
If anybody shows up.
Well, town meeting, before town meeting.
Yep. Oh, yeah, town meeting. Yeah.
Is this a signage issue? Is that?
That's.
Yeah, Rick, you get the business signage.
Yeah, so this is a conversation we had in the last meeting. All it is. These are a couple zoning enforcement issues I've noticed that I want to send a letter to the zoning enforcement officer about. And if anyone wants to add anything into it, we can do so. So it's just one big letter versus different requests. If you want me to send it as an individual, I can do that too. But these are three things that I've seen. I don't know if I'm allowed to say names just because it's not advertised. So, I'll get myself into
it. Oh, I see what you mean.
Huh. Well, anybody have any objections to sending a letter to the, it's come to our attention?
No, I don't think I do.
So, is that all right, we'll send that letter?
And I don't know if you want to put a general statement with it too, these are some. And there are others. It seems like it's been falling by the wayside. I thought we, hired a person to do zoning stuff.
Yeah.
And, not that I want to be the sign police, but...
You know, I think we...
It seems to, that it's fallen by the wayside. I don't know, I could be wrong, but...
Let's be on record and send a letter out.
But I wouldn't say there could be others. Let's just refer to the specific language of this letter.
Or just say that this, it has come to our attention that there are some violations and we'd like to have you check it out and get back to us.
Yeah.
Is that fine?
Just check it out, yeah. And that's just, it's up to him to say yea or nay.
An appointment of a steering committee to study the use of town-owned land on Irish Way. Who would like that position?
To be on a committee?
What is it for?
It's the land that they brought for parking that was in Roger Woods' property that the town bought because they thought they were going to need it for parking for the high school.
Who else is involved?
The Board of Selectmen has put together a steering committee at the request of one of their members, I believe, to see what they could do with the land.
Interesting.
So there's...
Whether they make it into a park or what they do with the land now that they paid $500,000 for it.
I can tell you, just for informational purposes, that Abington Housing Committee that I'm on, this is something that, you know, Selectman, you know, Ken Coyle has mentioned that that is a possible piece of land, you know, that could be developed for senior housing or affordable housing. So I guess that's just giving you folks information.
Sounds to me like you could take that position. Would you like that position?
I don't know, I just, you know, and it's like other things, I got a problem with being presented and buying it for a specific reason, and now it's, well, let's do something else with it, but I get it.
Who would like that?
I get it. And I would not object to if they want to do something for senior housing.
It's only so many hours in the day, folks.
Tell me about it.
No, okay. If you want me to be on that committee.
Keep you off the street.
I'll agree that Bruce be on there as long as he pushes for senior housing.
Motion made and seconded, all those in favor say aye.
I start clearing this stuff with my boss.
Going to be retired soon, Bruce.
No.
The Austin of the Housing Production Plan.
So I gave you guys copies of it earlier, so you'd have plenty of time to read it, and I wasn't going to hurt any more trees.
I print out a copy, just in case anybody, this is the latest version that Laurie Muncy, who wrote it, gave to me.
Now, has this been endorsed by your other committee?
Yeah, the Housing Committee likes it. I've given copies of it. It's not a formal endorsement, but they like it because everything that's in here is something that the Housing Committee wants to do. So, and if you read this, it really is a very good blueprint. I didn't participate in writing this, but I know the person who wrote it. It's really good. And we've done this, Old Colony Planning Council has done this for several communities. It's a good plan to have. You know, of course, tonight we need to endorse it, and then the Selectmen need to endorse it, to ratify our endorsement with this. But it's my hope, as someone who's pretty familiar with this book and others, that the board endorses it. I can't make that motion.
I read most of it, I just can't recall every detail. Is there basically an action plan in there, steps to fix?
Yes.
I honestly couldn't, it seems like strategies develop every year, and you have to be up on it yearly as the way to do it.
But the best thing about this is that there is this is a doable strategy in this thing. This was written by a real professional.
I'll make that motion.
Motion made.
Second.
Any further discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Thank you, guys.
And that was to endorse it and then send it to the Board of Selectmen for their endorsement.
To ratify the endorsement of there.
And response to 1149 Plymouth Street.
I left you a copy of what I received from Town Council in your pile.
In my opinion, based on review of the town's bill bylaw, the initiation of the enforcement action requires the planning board to establish the violation at a public meeting with written notice to the property owner and/or operator of the project. Once the violation is established, the board can issue a cease and desist order, order that the fill be removed, order that the property be remediated, and it may assess fines. If the board wishes to move forward with enforcement, I can assist in preparation of a notice. I recommend that the owner be given at least 10 days' notice. I also would recommend that abutters be given notice, although this is not required by the bylaw. Although the bylaw describes the requirement as a meeting, I recommend that the proceeding be conducted as a hearing with evidence of the violation and an opportunity for the owner to respond. I will be available on Monday if you would like to discuss this matter in greater detail. And as you recall, they put a lot of, and never has responded in all requests.
Mm-hmm. We've already sent them notice. Hmm? We've already sent them notice.
Yeah, so she'll have them do it.
Yep.
Have them write it up and follow through with it, all right?
All right.
Quick note on related sort of the house on Route 18 before you get to the mobile station on the lot. Bruce, this is coming in your neighborhood.
Mm-hmm.
Have they been putting fill out back? They have a fence up there around, but I think they're putting fill out back.
And they have, they just put that fence up. I sent them a letter.
Okay.
A long time ago because I thought they were putting fill. Actually, you guys thought they were putting fill there. And then the fence went up, and I think he had landscaping equipment there.
Did it change?
Did it change hands? Didn't?
Is this the house that Garvey drew up the plan? Is this something else?
Oh yeah. No, that Garvey was the one on Randolph Street.
Oh, this is different.
Yeah.
This is one right next to the mobile station. Garvey did the one on Randolph Street.
Something's going on.
Right by it, they put up a fence, and then if you guys are talking about fill. Up on Adams Street. So if you're going up Route 18 towards Weymouth and you look to the right where McGill's is, there's a ton of fill up there. Like mountains of it I can see over their fence.
Where?
Well, McGill's is? Is this
on Route 18 before you get to the zombie.
This the Giosi?
No. On Route 18 before you get to where the transfer station was going to be.
So they've been also storing.
Oh, Giosi's.
Yes. No, it's not Giosso's, it's past Giosso's, because that I wouldn't, because I know that's all entwined with Route 18.
Oh, is that Anderson Pierce?
Yes,
That's a Bach Mulch, right?
Yeah, on the
that's Bach Mulch.
Way over on the other side, I don't know what's up.
Is it Bach Mulch?
I have no idea, there were multiple piles of stuff.
Because he's been selling Bach Mulch out of there for years.
Yeah. I don't know if anybody wants to take a ride.
Because I know we walked the Giosso site, remember?
Yes. Yeah, so it's not that, because that's definitely, he almost has two sites, and both of those are wrapped up with Route 18.
All right. Is there anything else? Correspondence? Anything?
Mm-hmm. Yes, that must need a motion to adjourn.
I also clarified that I abstained on the vote on the housing production plan.
Okay.
Get everything covered.
Motion to adjourn.
Thank you, everyone.
Seconded. All those in favor, say aye.
Aye. Aye.